Robert Klippel was born in 1920 and spent his early life in Sydney. He is now considered to be one of the most significant artists this country has ever produced.
I was always wanting to make things with my hands, and I remember mostly when I must have been about six, being taken for a ferry ride and then coming home and having a terrific desire to make a model of the boat I'd been on. And right from that time, I just had to make model ships. I kept making them, making all through my youth and at school. That was what I was really interested in, making things with my hands. But I went to Cranbrook, and then I went to Tudor House, the boarding school, for 2 years, where I was running the workshop there. And the headmaster, in one of his reports, pointed out to my family that I have unusual ability with making things with my hands, and that some, you know, should take note of it. And I used to keep going, making these ships all the time, and breaking them up all the time. And then when I was about 14, I had some relatives in New Zealand who had a station over there, and I went over there for 6 months, and I spent the whole 6 months making a full rig ship, and that's all I could think about. And in any case, I was just fascinated with ships and adventure stories. All I could think about was wanting to be a sailor and going travelling the world and living an adventurous sort of life. I basically didn't want to be an engineer or a doctor or on the land or anything. In any case, I went to Sydney Grammar, and I was no good at school. In any case, I wasn't interested, and all I wanted to do was make these ship models. And then when I left school, when I was about 16, at that time, it was totally different to today. I enrolled in the East Sydney Tech to do a wool classing course because I wanted to be a wool buyer. I thought, well, I could make lots of money and you know, I could travel the world and do all these sort of things. And I went up in 1937 and enrolled and did half a year at East Sydney Tech, did 6 months with a wool buyer, 6 months back at the Tech, and then 1 year at Vickers Woolen Mill, that would put it brought up to 1939, and all I could think of then was wondering, I want to go around Australia, travel around, investigate Australia, and travel the world. And I couldn't imagine anything but making a fantastic collection of these really miniature ship models on the highest level. That was my main preoccupation, I suppose. When war broke out in 1939, I joined the Navy, and I was stationed on Cockatoo Docks as a guard, and then I was put on a minesweeper. I was drafted onto a minesweeper, and we went down to Hobart, where we were for a year, on Storm Bay, going backwards and forwards, sweeping for mines, which we didn't find any, luckily. And then I did a gunnery course at Flinders Naval Base, and I was drafted onto a Norwegian tanker, and then we were running up to Aberdeen. This would have been 1942, and then I got so sick and tired of being at sea all the time, 32 days at the time, from port to port, and I started thinking, well, there must be something I can do to get off this and do something I really like. Now, anything I could think of, because I've done this course called Pelmanism, which made you ask what you were good at and how you could really put it into operation, the only thing I could think of was this model making. So I got off when the ship called to Sydney. I complained of headaches and a bit of a racket, and they had to take me off because you weren't allowed to wear glasses on being a gunner. And I went round and eventually I got this job as model maker for the Gunnery Instructional Centre at Woolloomooloo, making models, aircraft for recognition. This would have been 1943. The thing I wanted to make most, I thought the highest point of model making, was to be able to make a 17th century ship model with all the ornamental scrollwork and figurehead. So I started going to the library and getting books on sculpture, and I started copying from these photographs these pieces of sculpture in wood, so that I'd bring my craftsmanship up to the level I had it with these other models I was doing. I was working down this, making these models, and then I started getting mixed up with people like Roy Norton and what I thought were artists who went to a place called Packy's, which was a bohemian sort of place, a nightclub or cafe or whatever you'd like to call it. And there, and while I was continuing to copy these wood carvings, copied from the like Epstein's people like Epstein, I started reading books like that. I was actually copying literally, and I remember doing a little relief of John Keats by Malvina Hoffman, just copying it literally for craftsmanship, with the idea of doing this whole thing, the figureheads and the sterns and all that. And I met this girl called Pam Broad about 1943, 44, and she one day said to me, "But why? I can't understand why you copying these things. You're just a craftsman, you know. Why aren't you know? Don't you know anything about art?" And I said, "No, certainly not. I'm never not interested in art. I never been to the art gallery, or if I went once, I was bored stiff with it. I knew nothing about it." And she said, "Well, why not try doing your own?" I said, "Of course. Well, why not? Exactly. Why copy them?" From then on, I did my first carving in wood in 1944, and from then on, I never went back to the ship models again. I never really thought I could ever give up these ship models. I thought that'd be my whole life doing that, but having some occupation which would give me enough money to do that. But in any case, then I got really involved in art and started to probe, you know, the nature of art and what it's about. And then at that time, somebody suggested, why not go up the tech and learn something about sculpture? And I said, "Oh, again, why not? You know, I'll give it a try." And I went up there in my sailor's uniform, and I met Dadswell, who agreed to let me in, and I had a teacher called Liz Blaxland who put me on to antique modelling of like Voltaire's head, Michelangelo's lips and skulls and that sort of thing, which now, after all these years, I find extremely valuable experience. I'm delighted I went through that. And my ambition, of course, was to work direct from life. I thought everything had to be figurative, you know, that was... But at the same time as while I was at the gunnery school, I was still kept going on these wood carvings on a fairly small scale. And during 1945, I went two nights a week up at the tech doing, and eventually Dadswell let me into his life class doing portraits and figure studies. And I kept questioning, what is the nature of art? Just what's it all about? Why has it got to be a figure? And, you know, at that early stage, I couldn't understand what's the point of it all. And I kept arguing. I took up long lists with me at night to Dadswell, questioning him all the time, and a lot of which he couldn't answer. I suppose it was just too much. A long list of asking what art's about. I got out of the Navy at the end of 1945, and I enrolled at the Tech full-time under the CRTS government thing, and went up there in 1946 to begin to be, you know, to thinking I'd be a sculptor. And when I got up there, they I started arguing with all the students because I don't know what I thought about sculpture by this time. What they thought about was totally different. And what Dazzle thought and what everybody thought was a totally different thing. And my wood carving by that time were becoming fairly abstract, and the sort of things they were teaching didn't seem to have any connection with what I was involved with in my own personal work and my writings and my jottings and notes and things. It seemed all beside the point. The little bit I saw in these odd books I would pick up seemed so exciting and different, and I thought it all seemed so academic to me. Nobody was questioning anything, I think. The only person I had any sympathy with at that time was a person called Jack Giles. We've had a long correspondence all our lives since then, but he's never continued, but he was the most brilliant student at Tech. And it was on the basis of our mutual agreement that Gaudí Abretzky was a great sculptor, but nobody else thought that. They all thought I was being romantic and sentimental about that and having a thing about it, and I never felt that. However, I thought he understood sculpture and, truly understood sculpture. But the point is, I didn't want to copy Gaudí Abretzky, and I didn't want to copy anybody. I wanted to just be myself. And towards the end of 1946, I had this friend called Harry Boyd, and I tried to do a portrait of him. He's a big fat cat, and I wanted to catch him. And I tried doing a portrait of him in clay, which didn't catch him at all. I tried doing it in... I had a workshop in Bond Street at this time. And I did that down there, and I also tried modelling a thing of Harry Boyd just to catch the essence of him. And I just couldn't get him, and it just made me all the more determined to then we'll do it. And I saw this piece of stone, which must have weighed over a ton, which belonged to Dadville. And as soon as I saw that piece of stone, I said, I feel I can do it. I just knew I could do it. And I used to go off from weekends posing Harry Boyd together, because I was very weak on anatomy and all these things, and I thought you had to know all about the thing, you had to draw marvellously, and I couldn't draw. I was terrible at drawing. I had a great inferiority feeling about that. That's why I made such a big effort later to really go into drawing in my own way as hard. I really pushed at it. But in the meantime, I decided, right, I'm going to do this carving completely sculpturally about the whole thing, and forget about Harry Boyd, but just catch the essence of him, not looking like him, but to be a pure piece of sculpture. Well, I finished this Harry carving at the end of 1946, when all the students had left, and I was at my father to subsidise me to go to London to try and find an art school which would be more dynamic and exciting, or, something with a bit more energy, because I'd felt that I couldn't learn anything more from East Sydney Tech. And he agreed to do that. And I think it was March 1947, I went to London. And I fortunately found a place called the Abbey Art Centre, outside London, where I set up a workshop, and later a whole lot of Australians, including Jim Gleeson, Mary Webb, and lots of other people turned up there. And at the same time I met Paolozzi and Bill Turnbull, and I was wanting to continue. My aim going to London was to go to an art school, and I enrolled in the Slade School through Paolozzi. He said, go there, and I said, okay, well, I'll give it a try. And after a lot of beating around, I got in there, and they were, was deader than the Sydney one. It appeared to the Sydney art school, and they were using calipers on the models, and I couldn't do that. So I spent 6 months' life drawing, but in the meantime, I was discovering the Natural History Museum, the British Museum, and Science Museum, all these things, and I was writing, jotting my little sketches down and looking at nature and finding a whole new world. It was all tremendously exciting. And playing, doing life drawing, which I couldn't understand the reason for, and doing these things which were non-figurative, and I got torn to pieces. And Jim Gleason was extremely helpful because he had this knowledge of art history and was able to point out to me, go it alone, and gave me the confidence to do it. And in the end, I walked out of the slave school and decided, right, after 6 months, I'll never go back to an art school. I'd rather not be an artist, if that's what it means, just making these figures and stuff I saw in the Society of British Sculptors and all the sculpture I saw around. I felt completely dead, and I wasn't interested at all in any of it. And then I was developing this theory of inner structure to a work, believing I had to get rid of the solid mass and start from scratch again and understand what went on within a carving. Once I understood that, I could really do a carving with significance, you know, with real form value. And all these years, that's what I've been trying to do. I've been still involved in that. I haven't really done any solid carving in all these years, but I just kept working away. Without me knowing it, I took on a so-called surrealist tendency. I didn't know anything about constructivism. I hadn't read anything about it. And I'm still interested in Gary Bredska and people like that, whose work I hardly saw any of in any case. And I was basically, and still am, interested in solid form sculpture, but my work became more and more linear. And then in 1947 or 48, I spent a great deal of time and energy on working on a piece called Machine Organic or Mechanic, Machine Organic or Organic Machine, was a piece I modelled over a year, which was a relationship between machine and organic form, and geometric and organic form, and trying to find the synthesis between all these aspects. And I'd be drawing upon all these aspects from the museums and nature and trying to bring it all together. And gradually, at the same time, I was making very fine, delicate wood constructions, which I painted, which were like inner structures for carvings. And then some of these pieces, like the one in the art gallery, the entities one, it turned out to be slightly surreal, and I knew nothing about surrealism. I thought Jim Gleason was a surrealist, and I didn't know any different. I thought that was surrealism, very realistic, naturalistic sort of work, which I was against any case. And so I just kept working away, and then the end of 1948, Gleason and I had a two-man show at London Galleries in Brook Street, which nobody was interested in at all, after which I still had a subsidy from my father, and I went to Paris, and I spent most of and there I was determined, even though I kept drawing all the time in London, to concentrate the year and a half I had there just on really getting down to drawing, which I had a thing about. I was so bad at drawing, I just had to try and master it. And I spent all my time drawing and looking at museums to sharpen my sensibility, going around the Louvre, Museum Guimet, and Museum Modern Art, all these, and looking at all these, and looking at nature, and trying to bring it all together. And it's all in my drawings that period, and of course, note-taking, which I suppose I always had to make notes because I didn't have people to talk to, and the sculptors and artists I met in Paris didn't interest me. I couldn't find anything of vital importance at all. Paris, when I was there in 1948 to 50, I had expected much more of it. I found that there was hardly any work apart from Rhea Pell's, whom I was a friend. Apart from him, I felt that there must be somewhere where true art of that period, of 1949-50, the rhythm of the time, as I would put it, must be more evident. And I kept asking around, and all I could get vague rumours about was New York was the place where really dynamic work was going on. And of course, that made me want to go there.
But for some unknown reason, I couldn't see how I could support myself there. But I felt I would have fitted in with the sort of work and my thinking on art would have been exactly right for me, but instead of that, I came back to Sydney in July 1950. When I got back to Sydney from Paris in 1950, I found a complete wilderness here. I used to exhibit with the Contemporary Art Society and joined that, and the Society of Sculptors and Associates was organising itself about that period, and they had their first open-air show in 1951 in the Botanic Gardens. And I made a 12-foot metal piece, my first metal piece, which I didn't make myself. I had to stand beside a welder and tell him what to do. And when that went on show in 1951, people thought it was just crazy. Keeping to the Society of Sculptors, I felt very little sympathy with the sculptors of the Sculptor Society. There was nobody with whom I had any real rapport. I liked them personally, people like Jerry Lewis and Dadgell or Joe Mason, all sorts of different ones were in it, but I didn't feel in my element. Nobody was searching or probing or trying to do something new in sculpture at all. And I don't know the exact date, but it must have been the end of 1950. I think I met Ralph Borson and Grace Crowley, and I felt terrific rapport with them right from the word go. We had a group show at the Macquarie Galleries of non-figurative work in 1951. And then after that, much to my surprise, I got a letter from Borson saying he'd spent 5 years organising and trying to get an exhibition at Macquarie Galleries, and he got it. And he would like to encourage me, and he invited me to share the exhibition in 1952, which I did. He had a lot of paintings, and I had 5 pieces of sculpture, and nobody appeared at the time to be interested at all. And it just seemed like a complete wilderness. The only sort of work that people seemed to like was more decorative work, or what we'd call charm school. Well, it must have been about 1953 that I met up with Bill Rose, John Olsen, Peter Upwood, and people who seemed to be in revolt against Passmore. I used to go around seeing the exhibitions, and everybody's raving. I'd go around and I couldn't see anything in it, because I, by this time, was going to the American Library and looking at art news, and realised that the sort of work that I was interested in was actually occurring in New York. In my own work, I was sort of doing very free work. I don't know if any connection with the New York school, but, you know, which I'd started in Paris. But I felt out of sympathy with everything which was happening. And in 1954, I got this workshop in Wild Street, Potts Point, and then I started to see a great deal of John Olsen, Bill Rose, and a lot of their friends. And by, I think, about 1955, I met Passmore, and I had a totally different impression of him when I actually spoke to him as against when I looked at his work. And I found him a pretty interesting bloke. And I think, I don't know whose idea it was to have an exhibition, a group exhibition that just seemed to come up, and it was called Direction One. For me, it was just another group show, a chance of showing my work. I'd been invited by John Olsen and Bill Rose to show with them. And I didn't have particular sympathies with Passmore, I liked them all personally, and they asked Eric Smith to be and the show went on, and a great publicity about this great new thing called abstract expressionism, and I didn't feel it was anything to do with this vital thing which had been happening in New York at all. the only one who did something exciting, a bit out of the ordinary, was Passmore. All the rest were just ordinary, I don't know what one would call the sort of paintings they did. Bill Rose was doing his sort of work he's doing now. To me, it was vastly overestimated. And they say it's a turning point in abstraction in Australian art, but abstract expressionism, as I sort of knew it from knowing Rhea Pell, was a totally different thing. I could see no future at all in Sydney to earn my living and do my work. And I thought, OK, well, I'll try going to America and maybe some possibility would exist to teach sculpture in America. So in about April 1957, off I went there, and I took about 14 pieces of my early work, which mainly consisted of very delicate coloured wood construction, some of which were in this show I'd had with Olsen. And I arrived in New York, and I met up with a lot of people I knew from my Paris days, and one of them, Sidney Geist, introduced me to Richard Stankiewicz, and I showed photographs of my work to him and some of his other group, which they had a gallery called the Hansa Co-op Gallery, and they were all very excited about this work I'd been doing out here and wanted me to have an exhibition. It was all more or less arranged. And then I go down to clear the work through customs and found practically all of it smashed to pieces. The whole lot was gone. But in any case, I was introduced to Dr. Bryan, who was director of the Minneapolis School of Art, who invited me to go out to the art school in Minneapolis for a couple of weeks, and then he said, would you like to come and teach you? I said, absolutely. So I went out to Minneapolis in 1958, and I might say by this time I'd done quite a lot of work. Somebody lent me a workshop, and I got cracking and did a whole lot of work combined with what I had left from Sydney, and I had a show in 1958 at the Palmer Gallery, and which sold quite well. And I couldn't believe it. And I only sold one piece of work, a piece of sculpture, just before I left Sydney, 25 guineas. That's the only piece, and I sold a few drawings before that. And to sell sculpture for $600 and $700 staggered me. You know, I couldn't believe it, and I was completely unknown. I stayed in Minneapolis from 1958 to 62, when I thought I'd give New York one more try to see if I'd like living there, because the first year I was there I hated it, I loathed it, even though I found it stimulating seeing all the exhibitions. And at that very time Richard Stankiewicz wrote to me asking me if I would like his loft, as he was going to move out to Massachusetts. And so I said to myself, right, I'll give it one more try and really live there and work there and see if I can get to like it and make my decision whether I want to spend the rest of my life in New York or not. So I resigned the art school, and in 1962 I took all my equipment and everything and moved to New York and set up my workshop there in a terrific place. And I never liked it still. I couldn't get to like New York. I had lots of talks with lots of artists and everything. I couldn't, you know, I wasn't basically impressed. I wondered, said to myself, well, what am I doing here? I prefer San Francisco. If I had my choice between New York and San Francisco, I'd rather be in San Francisco. And when I started thinking about it, I said, okay, I'd rather be in Sydney than San Francisco, where my roots are. And the old saying is, like Eliot said, home is where one starts from, kept being in my mind. And I said, right, I'll return to Sydney. So out I came, and I found Sydney completely changed. I've chosen plastics because I feel it's an extension of my particular vision, and there's such a different character of all this, the infinite variety of all the shapes which I change and transform by use of a jeweler's saw, and my concept and the possibilities, I couldn't do. It's a completely different thing down the metalworking workshop. And my aim is to eventually work on what I call these dioramas, like mountains and hills and everything, and instead of making them on massive scale, 100 or 200 feet high, I can, by using a small scale, put them in and they will read as such. And I would very much like to do one on a very large scale, spending years on it. And I'd like to work with James Gleeson, with whom I have good rapport, to do the painting aspect of things and just combine the whole thing. I'd like to ideally do it in a Bucky Fuller dome, where you walk up under into the middle of this thing and have the whole thing programmed from daylight to dark, so you get the play of light and the whole thing changing slowly all the time. Well, I'd like to use all the mediums, like wood, metal, plastic, everything, solid pieces, bring everything together in this project on a really big scale. And to me, it would be something very close to my heart. I'd really like that. I started out as a model maker and wood carver, and I feel this is just like another aspect of my work, like metalworking or plastic work or drawing. This is just the same sort of thing, but I can do certain things in wood which I can't possibly do in plastic or metal or clay or bronze, and I can only do it in wood. So I'm all set up here. I feel I haven't really pushed hard at this aspect of things for many years now, and I feel the surge sort of coming up that I'm really going to make a push at this very strongly in the very near future. These little, they're only little sketches, they're mostly kids' toys parts made up into small pieces of sculpture, and at this point, everything's just the beginning stages. I feel I haven't developed it fully, like I have the metal work or the other aspects. And in a year or two's time, I'll have all sorts of exciting things I hear, I hope. You know, I just feel everything got to be done in wood, and I haven't done it yet. I did do an awful lot of woodwork in my London and Paris days, and in the early 1950s, but then I got onto metal and the woodworking aspect sort of went down. But since I've got this house with this room just for wood, I'm really going to make a push in it. I feel I can do really good things in it. I can only do things in wood which can't be done in metal. If they could be done in metal, I'd do them in metal. If they could be done in plastic, I'd do them in plastic. Every concept, I believe, comes out, is right for a certain material. And if it could be done in any other material, I would do it. I don't organise my day. I could be, say for example, the last few weeks I've had a tremendous surge of drawing. I haven't wanted to go near my metal workshop or wood workshop or plastic room or do anything except just concentrate on drawing. And while I've got that surge of energy, I just got to do it. And when that sort of runs down, that rhythm sort of ebbs, then maybe something else will come up. It always does. It always, one runs down, another one comes up. I've got to feel this absolutely inner excitement and real drive to do something. Otherwise, it's not, you know, I just can't work. From my earliest days, I've always jotted notes down and written, which I regard just as important as my sculpture. Could be on seeing an art exhibition, could be on ideas about sculpture, any problems I have about sculpture, I'll jot it down, tons of questions, and then try and answer them. But I've just always been writing, and that, to me, it's just as important as drawing or making sculpture. I don't make any distinction between all this activity. It's all part of the same process. Well, I feel I have my own vision of what I think sculpture's about, but of course it's like a carrot before the donkey. I keep feeling that if I just keep going, working in all these idioms, that I will arrive at something, but you never do get there. I think it's completely illusory. Now, for example, these drawings, they're just part of the same process, like doing sculpture or working in metal or wood or clay or plastic. The whole thing's all one to me. It's all unified. I never think of an audience. It's purely for myself. And if anybody happens to like it, well and good. If they don't, too bad. I can't help it. It's my own world, private world. I'd like to think I've made some sort of contribution to sculptural thinking, but any posterity, as Duchamp said, will tell. I mean, leave it to posterity, he says, and I agree. Wouldn't like to make any judgments about my own work. I feel sculpture's hardly been touched. I wish I had 10 hands to be working at once in all these areas. I wouldn't want to go out there and make a mountain full of big pieces of sculpture. It's not for me. Let other people do that. I'd like to see it done by somebody, but to me, I just like it on this small scale. And I can imagine these as a tremendous scale, tremendously big, and yet they're tiny. And I think I have been under a bit of an illusion about this, thinking that I should be working on a big scale when basically I am a fairly small scale. You know, I like working on a small scale, starting out with my miniature models. Why did I like miniature model ships as against making big ships? It's just, you've got something. I think it's been quite logical that the ship models were miniatures. Why shouldn't my sculpture be on that sort of scale? I used to think there was something wrong in that, in sculpture, but in the ship models, I think, why should the miniature models are a very special thing to me.
Do you feel a close involvement with your materials, separate nature of each of the materials you work in? Do you respect that separateness of each kind of material? Paper, clay, bronze?
Yes, I do feel that, but at the same time, I'd like to crisscross them more. I'd like, when I'm working in wood, to be able to use wood in relation to plastic and in relation to bronze, to bring all these things and crisscross the whole thing. What I am doing in these drawings maybe will rub off into another area I'm working in, and vice versa. I believe it's all interrelated.
Tell us whether you believe in God.
Yes, I believe in God.
Do you think artists are like God?
No, I don't. I don't think an artist is a special sort of person. I think one of my reasons for being interested in art is to come to grips with a deeper reality, or God, or whatever one likes to call it.
The interrelationships between things.
Yes, but I would think that spiritual values, I think art and spiritual values are very, very much related. And one can't have art without being in touch with some spiritual reality.